Good evening and a very warm welcome to you to the next episode of Diplomatic Faces. And we are privileged to have with us this evening the Acting High Commissioner for Pakistan in Sri Lanka, Dr. Safraz Ahmed Khan Sipra. Welcome to the program, Dr. Sipra.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pradeep, for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to talk about the both countries. I would like to say that I bring best wishes and greetings from the people of Pakistan to the people of Sri Lanka.
Thank you, Your Excellency. As you would agree, Sri Lanka and Pakistan enjoy an enduring relationship, close bond, a bond that goes beyond the official relationship of the government-to-government relationship. Would you like to say something about the culture, the heritage, the links that we have had with Pakistan over many centuries?
Well, thank you very much. Very important question. The linkage between the two people, Pakistan and Sri Lanka, goes back up to 2,300 years back. This was the time when the great king Ashoka, he was ruling the empire, this huge empire in South Asia. So during his time, Gandhara heritage and the Gandhara culture was created. And this is a small area in Pakistan, in the north of Pakistan, where Buddhism and Gandhara actually not only bloomed, but they reached their zenith. So till today, that link is still there. We have done a lot of work for promotion of the Gandhara and Buddhist heritage of Pakistan in lots of countries, particularly in Sri Lanka. Most of the time, the people of Sri Lanka, they don't know the story. They don't know the importance. They don't know that how big is the treasure which is there in Pakistan. And I would like to inform your audience that all the heritage and the artifacts and everything is very well preserved. We have got three big museums where the artifacts have been categorized, cataloged, and they are being placed in a very safe environment. So one is in Lahore Museum. The other one is Taxila. The third one is in Peshawar Museum. So these are the major places where the artifacts of the Buddhist and Gandhara heritage are preserved. And there are many holy sites. One is Taxila, and there are many places in Taxila. Taxila has been a university. Though it was not called university at that time, but it was a great center of learning. And I think in the entire South Asia, or I would say entire Asia, there were 60 subjects which were taught at Taxila. So you can just imagine, and the people from far and wide, particularly the princes and the nobles and their nobility, they would especially send their sons to get trained at Taxila.
It was virtually a place of learning.
Place of learning, including warfare, including everything. So planning, music, art, architecture, everything. There were 60 subjects which were taught at the University of Taxila. So the linkage is still there. As soon as, I mean, the Sri Lanka got independence in 1948, your Prime Minister, your founding father also, D.S. Sena Nayake, visited Pakistan. And he met with the founder of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah. And the two leaders, they immediately got to know that this is a relationship which is a special one. And both of them, they resolved to continue this relationship, which has been there for centuries, but in a very, very modern way. From that day onward, I think this relationship has gone from strength to strength. We have not seen any dip in this relationship. except that it has always been rising upward and upward.
And you have always supported Sri Lanka in various ways, especially during the conflict that we had. You've showed your support and stood by Sri Lanka in its most difficult times.
Yes, Mr. Pradeep, you are right to point out. I think it is a reciprocal thing. We consider it as a duty when the friends are in trouble. And particularly when Sri Lanka has got any problem, it is our duty to come to assist Sri Lanka in any, whether it's a conflict or whether it's a post-conflict situation. You see, if you have got floods, we are there. If you have got the tragedy of Kosalada, we were there. The first country was Pakistan to come to help. You have got the droughts, and Pakistan provided a gift of 10,000 metric tons of rice. So, I mean, this is a bilateral story. This is a sort of a reciprocal thing. Whenever we needed Sri Lanka was always there. So, it's not like that only Sri Lanka is getting the advantage. No, both the countries are getting this
mutually advantage. Beneficial.
Mutually beneficial. And this relationship, the beauty of this relationship is this, that it is based on trust, understanding, no compulsions, no bargaining, no nothing. So it is based, and it is more in the people. The leadership matters, but I think if you go to Pakistan, you will feel that the people of Pakistan treat Sri Lankans very, very differently than they treat the other foreigners. Similar is the case for Pakistanis when they come to Sri Lanka, and when the Sri Lankans get to know that he's a Pakistani, so they give him a very special treatment than the other.
What you say is absolutely true, because my mind immediately went back to the World Cup final that was played in 1996 in Lahore, where Sri Lanka beat Australia. And if you talk to most of the Sri Lankan cricketers who played in that game, they felt as if they were playing in their home country. They never thought that they were playing in a neutral country. So that goes to show the close
ties. I would like to add here that, okay, well, over there it was a home ground for Sri Lanka, right? During recent ICC Champions Trophy, when Pakistan reached the final, and we received lots of prayers, lots of support for the win of Pakistan team. And ultimately, Pakistan team won. And after that, I think both nations celebrated together. So that is the essence of the relationship, the beauty of the relationship.
What, talking about cricket, something that's close to my heart, what do you think is the key attribute for the sudden resurgence in the Pakistan team? As you just spoke about winning the Champions Trophy in England. There seems to be a lot of depth in the resources. There seems to be a new approach in the style of playing. What do you think is the success behind that?
I think it's the resolve of the Cricket Board of Pakistan. And they have made right decisions. Whether as far as the selection is concerned, and there has been tremendous emphasis on the training of the players. Particularly their psychology. I mean, if you have the winning psychology, only then you can win. If you go into the ground with a defeated psychology or the bent of mind, then you will never be able to win. So the best what the cricket board has done is to infuse confidence in the players that play as you as naturally as you want to. But don't think of defeat. Just think of the win. So I think this was the case when Imran Khan went the World Cup for the very first time for Pakistan. So this is again a repeat of the history. And at this point in time, I am very glad to say that yes, Pakistani team is highly balanced, very talented. It's a young team, and it is going to serve Pakistan for many, many years, coming years.
And it's ironic, Your Excellency, that the next tour is next series is between Sri Lanka and Pakistan.
Yes.
And after many, many years, you're going to have cricket again in Pakistan. How do you look at that prospect?
I can't express my happiness about this thing, particularly when Sri Lanka is going to Pakistan to play a match over there. So this is going to be the revival of Pakistan cricket internationally as well as domestically. And we are very grateful to Sri Lankan Cricket Board for agreeing for sending their team to Pakistan. So this is how, but we have also been discussing, and it is possible that Sri Lanka and Pakistan can be the partners of the Ashes series. Like the two countries, they can have the Ashes series like between Australia and England.
Getting back to just one more question on the cultural ties, what has been done to document this? And what has been done to promote exchanges, tourism between, you know, Sri Lankan Buddhists to those various regions of Pakistan that you spoke about, to get to know the rich heritage and the lineage of Buddhism that originated from that area?
Actually, it was a very deliberate policy to introduce our rich heritage of Buddhism and Gandhara to the people of Sri Lanka. For that, what we started with was that we composed a delegation of the senior most Buddhist monks, academicians, politicians, media personnel, and this delegation was led by the Honorable Speaker of Sri Lanka and the Honorable Minister for Justice and Buddha Sasana. He joined us little later. So it was a huge delegation of 42 members. So we took them to Lahore, we took them to Islamabad, we took them to other places, Taxila, and finally at Karachi. So they traveled through most of the parts of Pakistan, and they were so impressed. They were so impressed that when they came back, they talked about it a lot. They talked about it a lot, really. I mean, when they talked about it, the word is spread that, look, Pakistan has got such a wonderful treasure, which is not there in any other country. Gandhara is there only in Pakistan. So after that, during that visit, the request of the Honorable Speaker of Sri Lankan Parliament, Karu Jayasurya, we immediately agreed to institute Vesak as a festival in Pakistan. Before that, Vesak was never celebrated in Pakistan as a festival. So the first Vesak festival was happened in 2015. And a big delegation went from Sri Lanka, and only Sri Lankans were invited for the first Vesak festival. Second Vesak festival happened last year, and the third will happen this year. So, I mean, this is, I mean, a series, I mean, which is good. And many other delegations also went on their own. But there were, most of the delegations went at the hospitality of the government of Pakistan. So this is basically, the idea is that the people of Sri Lanka should know that what is lying there for them. They can go for the spiritual experience. They can go for the tourist experience. They can go for both experiences. Because the holiest sites of Buddhism, most holy sites of the Buddhism and Gandhara are lying in Pakistan. So I think very soon we will see that the private travel operators, they are coming up with the packages and those things so that everybody can travel to Pakistan. And it is very safe. It is very safe. There is no threat. That's unfortunate thing about Pakistan that it has been portrayed in the international media as an unsafe country, which is a total lie. The people, those who have gone there, they are totally converted for Pakistan. I can name so many of the important personalities and the ministers and the parliamentarians of Sri Lanka who have visited Pakistan. Now they say that we would like to go again and again. So in this regard, I would like to have your attention that the High Commission of Pakistan has created, compiled this book, Majestic Pakistan. If the camera can show it, please. Yeah, this it has got three volumes inside, in English, Sinhala, and Tamil, so that every Sri Lankan can read about it. If you allow me, may you open it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So it's a beautiful, and there are beautiful pictures inside with some description. So this is the English volume of this thing. This is, would you please, this is in Sinhala, and the third one is in
Tamil.
So, in deference to the language policy of Sri Lanka, we have
compiled it
both the official languages of Sri Lanka. Right. So, this is one small effort which we have done, and lots of people, those who have read this book, they were amazed to learn about Pakistan.
If we were to move on to the international sphere,
right?
I like to draw your attention to the issue of Kashmir.
All right.
Do you see any hope that this issue can be resolved with dialogue between Pakistan and India? And do you also think that the international community is playing a positive role in engaging these two countries to solve this issue in an amicable and just manner?
Okay. Well, maybe for the benefit of your viewers, I would like to give a little or would like to take you back to the history and the genesis of this issue, that how this issue has actually come into existence. You see, experience of getting freedom is totally different than what happened in on the other side of the border, what we call South Asia, or mainly the British Empire. So British Empire was divided in Pakistan and India. So the formula which was agreed for the partition between all the parties concerned, including the British, Pakistani leadership and Indian leadership at that time. So it was agreed that the Muslim majority contiguous areas will constitute Pakistan, right? So there were areas which were directly ruled by the British, but there were areas which are called princely states, which were indirectly ruled by the British. So the overall formula was that the princely states would accede according to their contiguity and according to the majority of the population. In case of Kashmir, unfortunately, this did not happen. Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir is a majority Muslim area. It is just adjacent to Pakistan. The borders are still there. So Pakistan was very keen to have it, and the Maharaja of the state of Jammu and Kashmir had a standstill agreement with Pakistan. But unfortunately, India moved its forces and occupied Kashmir, a major part of the Kashmir, which is called Indian Occupied Kashmir. Then the issue was taken to the UN Security Council by India. Over there, the UN Security Council gave its verdict in the form of resolutions that this is an international dispute, right? It's not a bilateral dispute. So the people should understand that it is an international dispute. There are three parties to that: India, Pakistan, and the United Nations. So the United Nations said, okay, well, we will have a fair and free plebiscite to determine the destiny of the Kashmiris under the UN auspices. But that never happened. That has prolonged the conflict. That has, because you see, when first you agree to something, and then you go back from that thing. That is not what occurs or what happens in the international relations. Pakistan is still very firm on its position that the Kashmiris should be given their right of self-determination through fair and free plebiscite, as has been decided by the UN Security Council. After that, unilaterally, India took an action and formed a constituent assembly of Jammu and Kashmir and made it an integral, declared it as an integral part of India. UN Security Council again came up with a resolution that this is not going to change the status of Kashmir. So still it is on the UN agenda. Some part of the Kashmiris are with Pakistan, and major part is with India. So, I mean, why Pakistani part of the Kashmir is totally peaceful through the last 70 years? There is no protest, no demonstrations, no killings, no deployment of the law enforcement agencies or the military forces. But why? Why on the other side? It means that the people of Kashmir, they are very happy with Pakistan, but they are not happy with the other side. That's why there is always a struggle going on, protests are happening, people are being killed, extrajudicial killings are happening, disappearances, all that sort of stuff. I am not saying this. You go and see what the Amnesty International says, what the Human Rights Watch says, what the other independent sources say. It is sealed. Thousands of the people have been killed. But why? It means that they are not happy.
So how long will this agreement prolong?
Well, anyway, I mean, this is only through negotiations. And Pakistan and India agreed to have a composite dialogue. And we had got many rounds of that. The composite dialogue does not only include the core issue of Kashmir, but many other five to six areas. Yeah. So we make the forward movement at least in some places like Siachen, like Sir Creek. On those, we were very close to the agreement. But somehow or the other, things didn't work out. So now for the last so many years, about 10 years, that Indian side is not willing to have any negotiations with Pakistan, despite our repeated requests and despite repeated agreements to have the dialogue resumed. You also asked me about the international community. International community, unfortunately, has not been able to play a positive role. Otherwise, this issue would have been resolved. But now it is only the Kashmiri people, those who are fighting for themselves. And they will continue. Because I think the most precious thing or the most fundamental right for any person, anybody or any nation is freedom.
Absolutely. Talking about freedom, how is the free trade agreement between Sri Lanka and Pakistan? Do you see it's going to have an impact, both countries, positive impact?
Yeah.
And what is the way forward?
Well, anyway, the free trade agreement between Pakistan and Sri Lanka had a very significant impact on the bilateral trade. It was operationalized in 2005 when the bilateral trade was just insignificant. But over a period of time, we actually crossed the figure of $450 million or $470 million in the past recent years. Then a dip came. But that dip was natural because it was an international phenomenon, that the global trade was suffering. So that had to have an impact on Pakistan and Sri Lanka also. But you see, there has been a resolve and commitment on both sides that the bilateral trade should cross the figure of $1 billion at the earliest possible. In that regard, my commerce minister, he visited Sri Lanka 3 times after His Excellency the President of Sri Lanka had visited Pakistan, and both the leaders at that time, the Prime Minister of Pakistan and His Excellency the President of Sri Lanka, agreed that this is the area where we need to have more focus. Consequently, Pakistan assessed the prospects very positively, and we came up with the idea of having single country exhibitions of Pakistan. So the first single country exhibition coincided with the visit of Prime Minister of Pakistan to Sri Lanka in January 2016. It was a resounding success. The people loved, and it provided a platform, a huge platform, where the two business communities were able to come together, to talk to each other, and to explore the ideas and to explore the future business and trade cooperation. Then we had, in 2017, this year, we had another single country exhibition. So that single country exhibition, again, on the very first day, there was nothing left, actually. Everything was bought. So the people who came little later, they were very frustrated that, oh, well, anyway. So the same thing happened in the first one. So I mean to say, this platform is providing an excellent place where the two business communities, they come together.
Interact
with each other. It is B2B, it's G2G, it is P2P. It is customer to customer also. So I mean to say, it has got a huge benefit for both sides. Now, we know that there is a trade deficit as far as Sri Lanka is concerned. Overall trade is increasing, is on the rise. The recent figures which we are getting, actually, your exports are increasing. Exports from Sri Lanka are increasing to Pakistan. Our exports are also increasing. But the positive thing is that the Sri Lankan exports are growing much faster than Pakistani exports. Particularly the betel leaf, Sri Lanka is the only country from which Pakistan imports the betel leaf. Tea is making a difference now. Now, in addition to that, what I would say is that we have declared Sri Lanka focus country for the year 2017. What do you mean by focus country? Like, it will have a special place as far as export and trade of Pakistan is concerned. So this year, every year Pakistan has got what is called Expo Pakistan. It's a mega event of Pakistan where lots of international buyers, domestic buyers, they come and visit. Sri Lanka will be provided a dedicated pavilion this year at Expo Pakistan. And EDB and the High Commission and the Trade Development Authority, we are all working together to make it a success. So when Sri Lanka goes there and the companies are there, their products are there, they will not only be showcasing it to Pakistani buyers, but also to the international ones.
That's very, very, very gratifying to note.
Yeah.
As a diplomat, how are you enjoying your stint in Colombo?
I think this is most satisfying and most beautiful stay. It's like my home.
Thank you very much.
We have got a great access all the time whenever we want to meet anyone. Or
it's been indeed a great pleasure talking to you. In this short period, you spoke from your heart about the very, very close ties that celebrate a unique relationship between our two countries. Dr. Safraz Ahmad Khan Sipra, our grateful thanks to you for being here. And on that note, we end this episode of Diplomatic Faces, and we look forward to seeing you next Saturday at the same time. Good night.